This was me and my friend on vacation in Portugal. And this was us when our electric car ran out of juice. You see, we were driving through a more rural area and had just crossed the border to Spain. There were fewer charging points, and the ones that did exist were broken. All of them. This happened in 2022, so charging infrastructure in many places has gotten a lot better since. But if I'm being honest, this experience made me more wary of traveling long distances with an electric car. Even nations with pretty solid networks can have holes like these where you won't find a public charger, particularly in rural or low-income areas. But don't forget that this is a process our good old gas stations also had to go through. And EV infrastructure is already catching up. Let's take a look where the rollout is working and why. When it comes to EVs and their charging points, we have a classic chicken and egg problem. Drivers won't buy electric cars if they don't have anywhere to charge them. But for companies, there's no money in building them in areas where there aren't a lot of EVs. Let's zoom in on the US. You'll find lots of these babies in cities, especially in affluent areas. But you'll be pressed to find chargers that are open to all in areas where there aren't a lot of inhabitants or where people can't afford to buy electric cars. Just compare EV-crazed California with more than 17,000 public charging locations to rural North Dakota with a total of 96. You're way more likely to stumble into a charging desert here.
A charging desert is an area when people cannot own an EV or cannot travel to because there are no chargers there.
Gil Tull is the director of the Electric Vehicle Research Center at UC Davis in the US.
And a charging desert is very different than a regular desert. A charging desert can be downtown of a city that if you live there, you have no chargers. And it can be sometimes that you live there and there are chargers, but you cannot use them.
That could be because they're installed by employers who lock up their parking lots at night, for example, or because they're broken. Harvard research found that in the US, about 1 in 5 public charging stations do not work. But that doesn't mean that the US hasn't already made a lot of progress. We have to keep in mind that developing a functioning network of chargers across such a huge country takes time.
It's really no different in how we think in some of our areas about just even gas or gas stations and other fossil fuel infrastructure.
Alexia Melendez-Martineau is a senior policy manager for Plug in America, a nonprofit that promotes the use of all kinds of electric vehicles in the US. She says it's important to remember that this also took a while to roll out. Back in the day, car owners used to buy their gasoline at drugstores, general stores, or even get it home delivered. It took about 30 years for Americans to go from that to curbside pumps to a sizable network of actual gas stations.
Filling stations sprang up by the thousands, and a whole new industry in gas and oil was created.
After years of fearing their car could run out of gas mid-drive, motorists were able to travel further and further across the US.
We have to be strategic about installing charging infrastructure in a way that's going to support our travel the way that we have, you know, with our gas infrastructure as well.
The big difference between the two systems is gas mostly relies on these external structures, but the majority of EV charging is done here, at home. Especially in the rural US, where EV owners have room to power up in their own garages or driveways. That's the thing. A map like this might scare you off at first glance, but it doesn't show private chargers that often do cover the day-to-day for locals. At-home chargers won't save you if you're just passing through, though.
The main issue is to create these networks that if you do leave your home, you can get to the nearest city. And the goal in the US is a charger station every 50 miles.
This distance should be able to hold over EVs, which can have a range of 240 to more than 600 kilometers, depending on how much you're willing to spend. The 50-mile goal was established under the Biden administration as part of the National Electric Vehicle Infrastructure Formula Program, aka NEVI. The $5 billion program, launched in 2022, gave funding to states to set up charging points, particularly along major highways. Because Biden's aim was to have a total of 500,000 public chargers by 2030. Just over 125 NEVI ports had been installed when the new administration suspended it. After all, Donald Trump has a different take on EVs.
They don't go far. They cost a fortune, but they don't go far. So you're in the middle of the desert, you say, you know, we're running low on electric. Do they have a charger around anybody? They're charging?
The good news is that states collected a lot of data in preparation for the program, answering questions like,
where should these chargers be going? How do residents plan to use them?
And that data hasn't gone anywhere. If we zoom out of the US a little bit and head over to countries that are leading the charging infrastructure game, we will see that state support is a massive part of this journey.
Government commitment is very important.
This is Susong Lee. He's the managing partner at the Korea office for Roland Berger, a global consultancy. South Korea is the clear leader when it comes to EV charging. It has the lowest number of electric cars per public charger. And it has the most kilowatt available per electric car. More kilowatt means faster charging. Meanwhile, the US didn't even make top 10 for either of these categories. One key driver has been the amount of money the state has poured into this development. Just in 2025, Korea raised its budget to nearly $450 million US per year. That's over 40% more than last year. More than half of that investment is dedicated to fast charging, both public and private. As a comparison, the US had earmarked about double that amount per year if NEVI hadn't been frozen, but it's also a much larger economy. Some of Korea's budget went to placing more charging stations along highways, for example. The Korea Expressway Corporation, which is partly financed by the government, commissioned ultra-fast charging stations at expressway stops. And the government tackled parking by mandating that all new apartment buildings install EV charging stations in 5% of their parking spaces. Old buildings need to retrofit at least 2% of their parking spots. The country also has another ace up its sleeve, its big businesses. These have access to lots of commercial real estate where chargers can be installed.
Our economic structure is mostly, big conglomerate driven. Conglomerates has every business under their name.
You've heard a lot of these names before. Samsung, LG, Hyundai. One good example is Lotte, which owns hotels, supermarkets, and department stores.
Once they decide to deploy the EVs, they can put the EV chargers in their own captive market, right? So, every building they have.
Think gas stations, parking lots for convenience and department stores. This is something conglomerates around the world can do. The Netherlands is another top player. While the country also promotes the rollout of private chargers, public ones play an especially important role here.
70% of our cars is parked in public space.
Roland Ferverda is the managing director of NKL, an organization involved in the public charging of electric transport in the Netherlands.
So you have a very active dialogue with your citizens. You know, what do they find comfortable in the distance they need to walk to a charger from their home? Yeah, is 150 meters sufficient, or could it be 250 meters? And that very much influences the density of charging that you put up in your streets.
In most Dutch cities and municipalities, you can even request a public charger near you if you don't have the possibility to power up your EV at home. But Ferverda says that the trend has moved from collecting data from the requests to predicting where new ports might be needed.
We know which areas will have which kind of development, of electric vehicles. So we can anticipate a bit on it. And we also have, of course, data from existing chargers. So we also see if, for example, the occupancy of a charger is above 70%, we need to put a new charger next to it.
Yet even Korea and the Netherlands are struggling in their rural areas. They might be much smaller and more densely populated than the US, for example, but here it's also true that
the business case is not yet okay, in those rural areas.
When there aren't enough people charging their cars in those areas, how are companies supposed to set up shop there? Well, in Korea, some of the people who know these communities best took matters into their own hands. Nonghyup is a group of agricultural cooperatives, kind of a national system for farmers. It owns places that become hubs in these rural areas, supermarkets and banks. And now it's working to install its own EV chargers there.
They don't expect any profitability. They only serving only for the people living in the rural areas. and try to increase the penetration of the EVs through that way.
In the Netherlands, municipalities also joined together to make a more salient business case. Instead of each municipality giving its money to a different operator, they combine forces to make one large order to the same company.
One big concession, which becomes attractive for commercial operators. So they start being interested then. It is maybe three charging stations in this village and five in that village, but take 40 villages and you suddenly have something of substance.
Now the EV rollout is going to look different in every country. But experts say that what we just saw in these examples, a strong push from the state and a focus on the user's needs, are key ingredients to install more chargers, especially in places the free market isn't that attracted to.
It will take many years to make money. That's why we need government to help.
That's exactly what NEVI did in the US before it was paused. It poured huge investments into the rollout and incentivized states to ask its citizens, what do you need? Now that it is in limbo, all eyes are on private companies to see how they're stepping up. Because many people, especially those living in rural areas, have a lot to gain from a stronger EV presence.
They often drive farther. They often have older vehicles that are larger, that are also less efficient. And so when you think about switching to an EV, those cost savings on fuel and maintenance can be incredibly impactful for rural households.
But that jump will only become possible if they have enough places to plug in, even outside their homes. What's EV charging like where you live? Let us know in the comments, subscribe to our channel, and check out dw.com for more stories like this.